All right, so we are very excited to welcome Andrew Deacon to our Alumni Career Chat series today. And Andrew is joined today by members of our career development team, myself, Tegan O'Connor, Employer Relations Coordinator, Dora Moreira, who is our Assistant Director for Career Development, and Manching Tom, who is our Assistant Director for Student Employment. So Andrew graduated from Manhattanville in 2008, with a degree in art history. And while at Manhattanville, he was vice president of our student government association and was actively involved in community service through the Clark Center, formerly Duchesne Center, and their creative expression through art program, and also in orientation planning for new students. And currently, Andrew is working as assistant principal for Torrington Public Schools in Connecticut. So thank you, Andrew, so much for taking the time to speak with us today about your career journey and your time at Manhattanville.
Thank you so much for having me. It's such a pleasure to be here and to talk a little bit about my journey. It's been an interesting one, but certainly one that I could not have embarked on without my history at Manhattanville. Manhattanville certainly prepared me in so many wonderful ways. And I look back at that experience. I miss it so much, but I'm so grateful for everything that happened while I was at Manhattanville.
Andrew, can you take a moment to describe your current position as assistant principal for Torrington Public Schools and what motivates you to stay in your current role?
Sure. So I am currently the assistant principal at Vogel Wetmore School in Torrington, Connecticut. It is a school that serves students in kindergarten through third grade. We have approximately 600 students, so it's a rather large elementary school. Torrington is an urban center, so we have many of the problems that urban cities face in terms of education. And to be quite honest with you, when I was a student at Manhattanville, and even more recently, I never thought I would be an administrator. That was never a career goal, but it sort of happened, and I certainly wouldn't change it for the world. What I love most about being in an administrative role is both the ability to lead and to affect change. I think even more so given what we're currently facing in the world is that there's no more important time to reshape education. Education, from what I know it, really needs to be changed. Most importantly, what I see are issues of equity and access, particularly in serving in an urban center. I see how much students in my district are impacted by socioeconomic status and other particularly disenfranchising factors that limit their equity and their access to education. I think about the surrounding towns and what students there have and their access to education compared to what our students have. And it's quite upsetting. And often it comes down to money and how funds are allocated to our system. So I think that that's really important to me as a leader to think about that. But then I also think about how could I as a leader motivate staff to really think about how can we transform the lives of our students? How do we lead with relationships first? What I know is most important is that kids need relationships with the adults in their lives. When we build relationships, we know that they're going to be more motivated in their learning, that they are going to be more trusting. I think particularly of our students who come from backgrounds with trauma. And so how do we provide trauma-informed instruction that is really going to transform their lives and have them see that education is the path to really improve or enhance their lives. So those are just some of the things that are really on my mind right now that keep me going in this career. Education is vastly changing daily, every day. Most recently, receiving a lot of guidance on how we're going to reopen schools in the fall. And a lot of it is disheartening because what I know from the guidance is that it goes against what we know are effective teaching practices that truly engage students in learning. So how then do we rethink about how is education going to look in the fall while still thinking about how are we going to engage our students, knowing that we can't use the practices that we traditionally would have relied on.
That's really, it's so intriguing to hear, you know, how you were motivated to pursue a career in education after majoring in art history. And yeah, that's so wonderful to hear.
Yeah.
Can you give us an overview of, you know, right after you graduated from Manhattanville, some of the steps that took you here?
Sure. Yeah, so it actually goes back to my time at Manhattanville. I entered Manhattanville because at that time, and they may still have this major, they had a romance languages major. What I really wanted to do was, when I entered Manhattanville, was I wanted to become a French and Spanish high school teacher. That's what I really wanted to do. I loved studying French. I took it since middle school. And one thing that my French teacher in high school did a lot of was she introduced us to the French Impressionists and Post-Impressionists. And so when the opportunity came to take an art history course at Manhattanville, I just fell in love with it. I did take an education course at Manhattanville, and it was wonderful. But at that particular time, Manhattanville opened my eyes to so many things. Having come from a small community that wasn't very diverse, I said to myself, I need to take some time before embarking on a professional career in my undergraduate and allow myself or give myself the gift of time to explore more beyond education. Knowing in my heart, I would probably always become an educator, but the professors within the art history department just sort of took me under their wing and they saw my passion and love for the history of art and visual culture that I decided to major in art history and pursue that. However, I graduated at a time in 2008 when the markets crashed and finding jobs were a little bit of a challenge. So finding a career in the arts in New York City was really something I wanted to do, but it was nearly impossible without a graduate degree in art history to get a job in that field at that particular time. And so with connections I had back at home, I landed a job at a private school teaching French and Spanish, believe it or not. Because ultimately I had so many credits within French and Spanish that I had enough of a background to be able to teach it. And I ultimately did that for 2 years before deciding this is something I want to pursue a master's degree in. And ultimately what I decided was to attend the University of Bridgeport's internship program in elementary education and pursued a master's in elementary. And the reason I chose elementary education was back at Manhattanville, you had mentioned that I was part of the Creative Expressions Through Art program, in which what we did was once a week, we brought in homeless children from White Plains to come to our campus, and we engaged them in an art history and studio art program. And I was lucky enough to direct that for 2 years. And as part of the Castle Scholars Honors program that I was a part of, I had to do a one credit course in, can't recall at the moment what it was called, but a sort of a service requirement.
Independent study.
Independent, exactly. So what I did at the end of that independent study was I presented it to the art history faculty. And at the end of it, Jillian, Lisa, Megan Cifarelli, they were there bawling their eyes out. And Lisa came up to me, Lisa Raffinelli, and she said, you know, you have a gift for working with children, and I think you really need to honor that. And so that always stuck with me when she said that. And that was really my motivation behind going into elementary education. So once I completed that degree, I taught second grade and fourth grade. And at the end of teaching fourth grade 1 year, I found out that I was the teacher of the year for my school, which was so exciting.
Wow, congratulations.
Yeah, advanced to being the district teacher of the year. And then I was actually semi-finalist for Connecticut's teacher of the year, which was just mind-blowing. I could not believe that I received that honor, but it was truly remarkable. And from there, I knew I really had to become a teacher leader. So I received another degree in remedial reading. And so I was a district literacy specialist for a few years in Torrington, before now becoming an assistant principal. And I'm currently working on my doctorate in educational leadership. So my hope is to one day become a district administrator as a director of curriculum. I'm really passionate about curriculum and instruction, and most importantly, social justice issues within education. And this has been a passion of mine for years. And as you can imagine, with the climate now in the United States, I'm ever more passionate about it. In particular, my research is around elementary age students and LGBTQ inclusive curriculum instruction. So I'm really advocating for how do we include representations of LGBTQ individuals at the elementary level, because I truly believe that for students need to see diversity. They need what we call windows and mirrors, right? Windows into the lives of others and mirrors that reflect their own lives. But I believe students gain a deeper appreciation, a better understanding of diversity when they're exposed to it early on, at early ages. We need to start the dialogue as soon as possible so that we can really create a more peaceful and just world. So that's sort of been in a nutshell of my journey since Manhattanville. But if you think about my journey, everything goes back to Manhattanville. So when I think about socially just and my interest in that, that goes back to Manhattanville. That's part of Manhattanville's mission. When I think about landing in elementary education, that goes back to my work with the creative expressions through art. So everything really goes back to Manhattanville and my training there. And I couldn't be ever more grateful for my time there.
That was such a great story.
Yes.
Thank you.
It really was. Yes, very inspiring. And congratulations on all of your awards, which sounds so well deserved. So you mentioned, you know, creative expressions through art as one of the meaningful experiences you had at Manhattanville. Are there any other, you know, particular moments, events, or opportunities that sort of defined your time at Manhattanville as well?
Yeah, absolutely. I thank you, Man Ching, for reminding me about being a supplemental instructor. It's one of those things that have sort of gone out of my memory. And I'm so disappointed in that, because that certainly was so important to me, that experience. And also through the Castle Scholars Honors Program, I was a teaching assistant for the first year program for freshmen. And so I think those two experiences combined in working with undergraduate students has motivated me to now become an adjunct professor. So at the University of Bridgeport, I teach a course in children's literature for master's students who are becoming elementary students. And so that background and having those experiences have allowed me to understand how to teach within a higher education domain, which was really great. I think too, back to creative expressions through art, what that had done for me. Also, my interest in academics, as being the vice president of academics for the Student Government Association, as well as being an orientation advisor. I think the big thing here is that Manhattanville allowed me to pursue my interests, my goals, and there was never a limit to that. And even if Manhattanville didn't have something that I wanted to do, they allowed me to pursue that. And so they really allowed me to honor myself, but also to gain a deeper understanding of myself. When I came to Manhattanville as a freshman, I didn't really know who I was. I didn't know where I fit into the world. And Manhattanville very much gave me that opportunity to explore, which, as again, I'm so grateful for that. So there were many, many opportunities. And I think, you know, my best piece of advice to students is seize any opportunity you can, because it makes up who you are. It helps transform your identity. And it's just so important to, like I said, explore and get to figure it out.
So you pretty much answered the question mostly, but were there any other ways that Manhattanville helped you prepare for your career path in art history and education? Whether it was through maybe specific courses or events?
Yeah, so I think a lot about the bigger skills that it gave me. So in terms of being able to think critically, art history fostered that so much in me. It really helped shape the perspective I bring to situations. So I think about art history and we think about the perspective we bring to a painting and how we interpret that. but I can transfer that skill into any situation. So when I'm thinking about a situation at my school right now in terms of, oh my gosh, how am I going to handle this? I think about, well, what perspective do I want to bring to this? How do I think critically about this? Instead of just acting right away, how do I take a step back and think about it through multiple lenses? So that was a big one. Another one was how to communicate effectively in terms of learning really how to write, to convey my thinking, to convey my thoughts, but to have that supported with arguments from research. So communication, thinking critically, collaboration was also really important. I learned how to be part of a team at Manhattanville. All of these skills are essential to the workforce today. And so don't think so much about the concrete skills that you're gaining from, but what are maybe the bigger, more global skills that have come out of your studies, right, out of a liberal arts college? And then how do you then utilize those in your career journey?
In terms of yourself, what would you consider to be the most useful career advice you ever received?
Oh boy, you know, it's gotta be to follow your heart. There's not one day that I wake up and I don't wanna go to work. I love what I do. I love going to work every day. And if I didn't listen to my heart, if I didn't listen to what I was passionate about, and then pursue those goals, pursue those dreams, I don't think I would have the happiness that I do today. And I truly believe that Manhattanville pushes you there. They show you how to follow your heart, how to follow your dreams, that happiness is important. And so that meant so much to me because, like I said, I can go to work every day and be fulfilled and be happy. Work is not something that I dread, and that's key. Because I do not want to be doing something that I don't enjoy. And, you know, so the biggest piece of advice was really follow your heart, follow your dreams, your passions. Don't give up. I mean, it's not to say, you know, I've been through some hurdles, but you overcome them. And I think Manhattanville really prepared me to overcome those hard moments. You are going to fall, but it's about how you pick yourself back up and move forward. That's really key.
Thank you so much. So are there, you talked a little bit about the awards that you've won from teaching. Are there other moments that stand out in terms of your accomplishments, and what have been also some of the challenges that you've faced in your career?
So some of the rewards, really one student put this so eloquently, one of my fourth grade students, at the end of the year, I always ask for a reflection on how was fourth grade? You know, what should Mr. Deacon do better next year? What should he change? And then the last question is telling a future student of mine, you know, what would you want to tell them? And this fourth grader said, make sure you listen to Mr. Deacon's advice and all he has to say. Because of him, you know, I feel empowered to make a change in the world and to make a difference. And to hear that from the voice of a 9-year-old was quite profound. To read that was truly remarkable. And then one of my former second grade students sent me an essay he wrote about me when he was moving on to middle school. And I don't even remember this story, but he remembered it. So that goes to show some people remember things that you don't. So, but he said something.
They're always listening.
Yeah, exactly. And he wrote about how he was doing some work on multiplication, and he happened to be doodling his paper, and one of his peers told on him and said, you know, Johnny, for example, is doodling on his paper. And he wrote in his paper that he recalled me coming over to him and saying to him, that was okay. It made his multiplication more interesting. And so the moral of his story was, Mr. Deacon taught me on that day that it was okay to be different. Mm-hmm. And that just, when I read that, I was like, oh my goodness, because you never know when you're leaving those subtle messages for students and how they interpret the world that they live in. And so it wasn't, you know, until 5 years later that I received that story from him. And he wrote that as a sixth grader. And to think that that's what he was still thinking about has such an effect on me and really told me, wow, how lucky am I to be in this career to make such a profound impact.
Amazing.
Who
Yeah.
That is so powerful.
In regards to challenges, oh my goodness. You know, I think as a self-identified gay male in education, you know, thinking about how do I navigate that, right? And for me personally, my sexuality has never been an issue within my career, or never have I felt that others have judged me for that. But at the same time, it's always in the back of my mind, right? That how do people perceive me? How do I maybe have to act a little bit differently than, say, a straight white male in administration? It's very different for me. I have to be more cautious. And so to think, how do I navigate that? You know, and I don't want to say to protect myself, because it's not about that. It's more about how do I make a difference? How do I make a change? How do I have people see that I can be who I am, but I can also be a leader within a school? And so that's something I'm always grappling with. And like I mentioned, you know, it's never been an issue. It's been more of an internalized thing for me. But, you know, if you come from a diverse background, you understand, you know, what that is like and the challenges that are associated with that. And so I'm so grateful for what's happening in our country right now. You know, the disenfranchised are making a movement here. It's about time, because we're all equal, you know? It's sad that it's taken to 2020 to do this, but ever more I'm so grateful that, you know, we're raising our voices. We have to. You know, that's probably one of the biggest challenges, you know, in my professional responsibilities.
Thank you so much.
So who do you consider to be your biggest influencer, or someone you look up to that has helped you in your career?
Oh my gosh, there are so many. It really has to be all of my teachers and professors, all of the educators in my life who impacted me. To be quite honest, you know, my parents really never thought I would be in education, given the experiences that I had in high school. As you can imagine, coming out in high school was not an easy feat, you know, and the discrimination that came along with that. And so to find myself in a career in education is something that many people were surprised by, even though I used to play school in my bedroom at 5 years old, and I loved it so much. But given those experiences were very hard, but it was my teachers who told me, don't give up. You are one who's going to advocate for change. You are going to show the world who you really are, and you're not going to back down. And so, you know, with my teachers throughout time, even to this day in my doctoral program, who, you know, tell me you can do this, don't give up, who have really made the most profound impact on me. And so for them, I'm forever grateful.
It's wonderful.
That's just amazing.
The relationships, those connections, it goes back to that piece that I was talking about earlier. That's what sustained me. That's what kept me going. I mean, if you look at some of the research, the suicide rates, for example, amongst LGBTQ students, it's really disheartening. I could have been that statistic, but because of the relationships, I had a purpose. I kept moving forward. And that was so important to me.
So great to hear, Andrew. In terms of unique skills, whether they're hard skills or soft skills, what skills do you see people bringing to the table in your field? And how do you suggest students cultivate those skills?
That's a great question. In one of my principal interviews, they asked me, what do you look for when you are hiring staff? And I have to say, the most important thing that I look for is somebody with a growth mindset. So I'm looking for somebody to enter the teaching field with an open mind that there is going to be so much to learn. I mentioned this earlier, education is ever changing, and there needs to be a willingness to adapt to that. There needs to be a willingness to consistently improve your practice. And so a teacher who comes in to an interview saying, oh, I know everything I need to know. My teacher preparation program gave me every little piece of information. Nope, sorry, not taking it. Because I want people who want to grow in their field, in their career. That is critical to me. I myself am constantly learning, constantly engaging in professional development opportunities. So that would be my number one most essential thing that I want somebody coming into education with a growth mindset, a willingness to constantly improve their practice, which is so important. And then again, the relationship component, that there's a willingness and a love of children. You have to love children. It's quite funny. You'd be surprised. There are some in the field who do not love working with kids, and it's so surprising to me. Love. Of course, the collaboration is so important. We know from research that one of the strongest effects on student teaching is teacher collaboration. When teachers collaborate together, we have desired outcomes on students. And so a lot of people enter the teaching profession thinking they're working in a silo, that they can close their classroom door and do what it is that they want to. But we know how ineffective that is. And so it's key to have a willingness to collaborate with your peers and to learn from one another, to go in to your peers' classrooms and formally observe and provide feedback and suggestions for how to improve your practice. Again, that stems back to this whole growth mindset piece that I was talking about. So there's that. There's adaptability and flexibility. So much is changing. I can think back to the pandemic, how rapidly things were changing. We gave directives to teachers one day, and then the state came back and said something 3 days later, and we had to totally reverse our course of action. And so you have to be flexible, because at the end of the day, yes, it's about you. Yes, it's about your passion in teaching, but it's about the student first and foremost. You enter the profession because the love of the student, it's growing the student, it's seeing their achievement and success that are really key. So, you know, again, I don't think I necessarily got into those hard skills, because teaching is so multifaceted and there are so many hard skills that you need. But I think it's, you know, those more global ideas that are so key to being a successful educator.
And I think those skills you mentioned, you know, the flexibility, adaptability, collaboration, those are skills that everyone needs in any job or any industry right now to succeed.
Absolutely.
So is there anything else that you would recommend to our students who might be interested in teaching or the administration side of things in schools?
Yeah, absolutely. I think the biggest thing is that it's such an exciting time to affect change. And I see so much coming out. So for example, in thinking about the Black Lives Matter movement, there's a lot of talk there about changing police departments, but it's not that. I mean, it is that, but it starts with education, right? Education, that's where students become accustomed into our cultures, into our values. And so how do we transform education to be a microcosm of our society to project what it is we truly believe? And that's where I think we're going to make the movement. Yes, there are many other facets and many other parts of moving pieces that will help make the change too. But we got to grab these kids at a young age, and we need to show them the power of their voice in making the kind of change we want to see in our world. And I'm seeing it in some classrooms. It's really quite beautiful. I remember being in the classroom when gay marriage was legalized, and I had brought it up to my fourth graders. And they, quite frankly, were like, couldn't even figure out why it was even a concern, why, you know, it was never legalized before. And so you just learn to see how, as they grow up, their biases form. So if we, at a younger age, what we believe to be socially just, it is so critical. So now's the time. Enter education, even in the field of art history, thinking about how do we dismantle a one-way perspective. You know, how do we encourage more female artists, Black artists, Latino artists, and how do we rise them up within the canon of art history, right? So if we think about the artists that we most frequently study, they're white men. You know, so even within the field of art history, how do we give more, you know, vision to these other artists that have been so influential within the history of art? So, you know, I think it's just a really great time to take everything that you learned from Manhattanville, because Manhattanville will prepare you to be socially just and to take that out into your future and your career.
You mentioned some skills that are necessary for public school administrators and teachers. What are some other recommendations you would make to someone interested in working in K-12 administration?
So I'm always drawn back to the standards for school leadership, that being a visionary, right? How do you establish a vision and a set of goals for your school? And then how do you share the responsibility around that mission that you have, which is so important, because without that, you don't have a driving force behind where it is you want to take your institution, where it is you want to go. And it also doesn't ground you. So without having that vision, without having that mission or set of goals, you're kind of heading in all different directions and it doesn't feel good. When you and all your stakeholders know where it is you want to go, then there's less anxiety, less stress, because people know where you want to get to. And then it's the whole work of getting them on board, right? How do you get them to take ownership of where it is you want to go? How do you capitalize on their strengths to move them in that same direction with you? What sort of skills and beliefs do they bring to the table that is really going to help move your institution further? So I think about that. I think about curriculum and instruction. What is it that we want students to engage in, right? I have a problem with a lot of education today because it's very similar to the structure of the 17th century one schoolhouse. I mean, we're doing a lot of the same things still, and we know that that's just not effective teaching, right? So how do we rethink and reimagine education within the 21st century? Because students are disengaged in learning. That's a problem. And we as adults, as educators, we're so accustomed to the way we were taught that it's just most natural for us to teach that way too. And so if we continue that, we're going to perpetuate this way of teaching that we know is ineffective. So how do we step outside of what we're comfortable with and think about how are we going to engage students, whether it's through technology, through play-based learning, through problem-based learning, so many different ways to prepare students. You know, I'm sort of nervous for our future. I don't know that we are necessarily creating individuals who are ready to go out in society and with the knowledge to affect technological change. So I think about most recently the rocket that went up to the space station. Mm-hmm. Are we creating enough individuals to maintain our interest in space, for example? Are we producing individuals who can come up with a vaccine to combat COVID? I'm not so sure with the ways in which our schools are currently functioning. So as a leader, I'm constantly thinking about that. And then how do I, when we have resistant teachers, how do I then motivate them, right? How do I think about, you know, how change theory works? Oh gosh, and there are just so many different aspects. And, administration.
Yeah, that's just incredible insights.
Yeah, I mean, those are two big pieces that I could think of.
Great. So, Andrew, we're going to bring you back for a moment to your life at Manhattanville.
Sure.
If you had to do it all over again, would you do anything differently?
You know, I don't think I would. No. No.
Okay.
I maybe would have studied a little bit less. I was crazy and I took 7 courses every semester. I took the max, I think it was 21 credits.
Uh-oh.
Yeah, I'm a little crazy. I'm a little insane. So I maybe would have, well, even that I don't think I would have done less of, because I loved every single course and I was there because I wanted to be. But, you know, one of my goals was to graduate within 3 years. And then I think it was Jillian or Lisa Raffinelli who said, no way, you're never going to get these 4 years back. You have to do 4 years. And I'm so grateful I stayed for all 4 years, because I look back now and it's like, I really did 4 years there. I mean, it went by like that. It was so fast. So no, I'm staying in touch with so many of my friends from Manhattanville and the professors. And it truly was a family for me. And I think that was the most important thing, is that I had a family at Manhattanville. And yeah, so no.
Okay.
There's nothing I could have done differently.
And then our last question for you, are there any resources? I know you mentioned you're working on your doctorate right now. Any resources that you would recommend for students interested in the field, either podcasts or books or any?
Oh, gosh. Well, you probably don't want to see my library of books. That would be a whole other session we'd have to do. You know, nothing comes to mind right now. I guess my biggest piece of advice would be to just try to stay current. So like ASCD, which is the Association of Supervision and Curriculum Development, they put out monthly briefings in a magazine that is really around hot topics in education. There's something called the Marshall Memo. If you Google Marshall Memo, you can go online and I believe you can sign up for his weekly newsletter. And he synthesizes the most recent research and articles within education. So there are many, many ways to stay current within education. So no, there isn't one place I would send people to, because the field of education is so vast, so much out there. Sometimes it can become a little overwhelming with, you know, what should I go to? What is a good resource? But if I think of something, I'll send it to you.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, Andrew. This was so wonderful hearing about your journey.
You know, I don't know what your next steps are from here, but do know that I am more than willing at any time to take emails from students or phone calls, whatever. You know, if there is anyone that after listening to this has questions or wants to connect, I'm more than willing, if that is something that your department is willing to do, please know you can count on me at any time.
Thank you, Andrew.
Take care of yourself and keep in touch. Best of everything.
Yes, you too.
Yes.